Winter Kills here, and welcome to the first of its kind, hopefully the first of many. We're doing sort of a podcast-esque thing here. We don't really have a name for it yet. We came up with a couple names recently, but we're not really decided. We don't want to come up with a basic name that could be used. Gonna try to make it a bit creative, but we're gonna basically be talking about at least the theme for this that we were talking about earlier is kind of just go over like weekly news and stuff, anything surrounding the game that may have, surfaced over the past week, or anything that's going to be coming out in the future, or just any topics in general that we want to talk about, whether it be serious, anything related to competitive player, just, telling funny Yu-Gi-Oh! Related stories or anything like that. But for the first rendition, we're going to be talking about some new support cards that were released for Spirals and Subterrors, our first few topics here. We've got Subterror and Spirals we're going to look at. So without further ado, I'm going to bring up the little Subterror page that I got here, and we're going to talk about Subterrors. So, Adam, I know you probably know a lot more about Subterrors than I do. Oh, and I forgot to mention, I'm also being joined here with my friend Adam and my brother Dave. So thank you guys for being here. And we're going to be talking about Subterrors first. So just looking at it, we got Stygo Kraken as level 5. And then we got Subterror Behemoth Ultra Mafis as level 12. Subterror Behemoth Burrowing Trap card. And then we got Subterror Nemesis Archer. All new support cards. Looks like they're coming out in INOV. At least I think they are.
Yep.
I'm going to, because I know Adam's familiar with most of them, but Dave, I'm pretty sure you haven't seen
Yeah.
some of these, as I know you don't keep up with the Subterrors, and I don't really either. It's kind of an odd archetype, but Adam's, I think, the only one out of the three of us that has the deck built, right? Yeah.
I've been trying to keep up, and I got a build on YGO Pro with the new support, and I've been testing that a little bit. It's not bad.
So we got Subterror Behemoth, Ultra Mafis, level 12, Pyro Flip Effect, Earth Monster. Stats are 3,000 attack, 1,800 defense. So it's pretty beefy, and it's a level 12, which I don't think we've seen too many level 12s
That's
in
cool.
the game recently. So that is very cool to see. So I'll read the effect off. So basically, the flip effect, you can change all other face-up monsters on the field to face-down defense position. You can only use this effect of Subterror Behemoth Ultra Mafis once per turn. When a face-up monster you control is flipped face down, if you control no face-up monsters, you can special summon this card from your hand in defense position. Once per turn, you can change this card to face down defense position.
That second effect is for all the behemoths. They all have
Yeah.
that effect.
So that gets summoned off mid shield Gardna.
Yeah, so basically you can just normal summon mid shield, flip it down, then you can just keep special summoning the behemoths from your hand if you have
That's
a
why that
bunch.
card's expensive.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's why mid shield Gardna jumped way up in price.
Yeah, and like, let's just look at the fact that when it's flip face up, it's essentially a Book of Eclipse just for your opponent.
That's insane.
That's
Doesn't target.
no, it's really good in the stats. Its defense is kind of weak.
Yeah.
I think that's kind of its downfall. If it had, maybe if its stats were reversed, I would see it being a lot better.
I think its attack is definitely good still. I mean, because
Yeah.
there's some terrors have bigger defenses than attacks. Like the Umastrix has a 27 defense and 2K attack, so like kind of average stats, I guess, for like a level 7 guy. But
Yeah.
none of them really have that amazing stats, honestly. They're
Do
just
they
all.
play a lot of battle phase traps?
Not really, because the Hidden City is kind of like a battle phase trap, because it allows you to negate an attack and flip one of your Subterrors face up if someone declares an attack on you.
Yeah, I was gonna say, because if they have a lot of weak defenses and your opponent's thinking like, oh, I'll just run them over, you play like Quakings and Drownings and just wreck them.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I've not seen too many profiles of Subterror.
Yeah, there's a lot of hype, I think, going around. Let's say that's why we saw the price jump, but we'll get to that when we get to the market section of the discussion here, the chat, the podcast, whatever you want to call it. Next we've got Subterror Behemoth Stygo Kraken Very cool looking card. Probably my favorite artwork, I think, for most of them, except for Umastrix and Hidden City. I really like those artworks. Kind of reminds me of Shulva Sanctum City from Dark Souls 2.
Soulslight.
Yep,
Yeah.
Soulslight. So basically, it is a level 5 Sea Serpent flip effect. I'm about to play this in Mermails. So the flip effect is you can target set cards on the field, equal number of Subterra Behemoth monsters you control, destroy them. You can only use this effect of Subterra Behemoth Stygrokraken once per turn. And then it
And
has the same effect as the rest of the behemoths.
yeah, I don't know. This one's not like as great, I feel like, because it requires like setup, like most of this deck does, because like you just need like a setup. You don't have like a really super powerful turn one play unless it's like the Prediction Princess
Yeah,
is your.
Territate does open up a lot of play.
Yeah,
Because
like
I feel like it
the
helps accelerate your engine.
deck needs Territory right now to like function properly.
Yeah.
Because than that, it's really hard to get going without Territory. I mean, Midshield Gardena is a decent starter card as well, but it's not as powerful as Territory just because you don't get that either player turn flip effect with
Yeah.
Midshield if you do Territory.
And it's also, looking at its stats, we've got 1400 attack and 2600 defense. So it's a stat lineup you would expect from a flip effect based archetype with really beefy defense, unlike we saw from Ultramaphis.
Yeah, he's got a big defense, but just doesn't. I don't know. I really don't like this one. I probably one or not.
Not as much as the Ultramaphis.
Ultramaphis is way better just because it's that Book of Eclipse, like
Yeah.
with no back essentially.
Yeah.
So I'd definitely rather prefer Ultramaphis over the Stygrokraken.
All right, now we'll look at the Nemesis. Now, Dave, I want your opinion on this from somebody who isn't really too familiar with Subterrors. Just as a standard effect, just taking it at face value, Subterrors Nemesis Archer, level 3, fairy effect, earth monster, 1600 attack, 1400 defense. Basically, at the start of the damage step, this card attacks an opponent's face down defense position monster, and you control another Subterra monster. You can shuffle that opponent's monster into the deck that does not target. If this card on the field is destroyed by battle or card effect and sent to the graveyard, you can special summon one Subterra monster from your deck in face up or face down defense position, so basically any of the behemoths. And then you can only use the effect of Nemesis Archer once per turn.
It sounds really good. I mean, first of all, the first effect doesn't target, which in the game right now, if it doesn't target, it's basically broken. If it attacks an opponent's face down defense position monster, is there a way in this deck to book things that, I mean, like
Yeah.
obviously behemoths do, but is there like a more direct way to do it?
Territory and
Territory
Witch
could.
Will.
Okay, I was gonna say, because like, people don't set stuff a lot right now, so that might be a downfall. But if that's the case, then it seems like it's going to be a three of staple, kind of like a farm girl.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And then obviously it replaces itself from deck, which is the best type of replacing, so it doesn't burn your in hand or engrave resources. So it seems really good.
Yeah, definitely from just, I mean, minus the setup, because like I said, you do need a Subterra monster, and it does have a face down defense position monster, but as we've seen from the past couple effects, is that your Ultramaphis, you flip that up, and then it, followed by a normal summon from this card, you're going to be able to shuffle back any problem card without having to worry about it. So I think it's definitely a little bit situational. Definitely, as Adam, you said, it does require setup, but
Gets
it's
around to
definitely,
Azure.
yeah, definitely a really solid card, I think, in general, just looking at it from face value. And I think you had told me earlier, Adam, this card is confirmed a secret rare in INOV.
Yep.
Yeah.
Secret rare is this girl. Ultramaphis is an ultra. And then I don't think we know the other two rarities yet. I feel like
Yes.
they're either rare or commons though, because they
Yeah.
don't seem like
Definitely.
that. But
All right.
yeah. Another thing about this archer though. I feel like this deck needs like a way to like. It'd be cool if you could like pop your own cards, because like if you just pop this, you just get a free Subterror from your deck, like the free like level 12 guy. That's just really strong if you get that turn one off somehow with her.
Yeah, no, you're definitely not wrong. That definitely, if like thinking of the way of Cosmo, the way they could, essentially pop their own cards to enhance their plays, like Slip Rider and Cosmo Town and Dark Destroyer with itself. to help just play more in, you know,
yeah.
card situations.
So yeah, I feel like that'd be kind of a cool like addition the deck could have, is just like a card that pops your own stuff and maybe like pops your opponents or something.
Yeah, no, that would definitely be really cool. Alright, now we'll look at I believe let's see here.
Trap card.
Yeah, the trap card. Let me just go ahead and pull this trap card up.
Yeah.
So that you guys.
Is it burrowing?
It. Yeah, it is burrowing.
Yeah, I don't know how I feel about this trap card.
Yeah, Subterra burrowing, basically, normal trap. You can banish one Subterra monster from your graveyard. Banish one Subterra monster from your graveyard for the rest of the turn. Face down monsters cannot be destroyed by battle or card effects, and your opponent cannot target them with card effects. If this card on the field is destroyed by a card effect, you can add a Subterra monster from your deck to your hand. And you can banish this card from your graveyard and then target one Subterra monster you control. Change it to face down defense position.
I'd play it.
Yeah, I mean,
I guess your field, like, on, you can't, like, you flip that and they don't respond to it, like, your field is, like, staying. Like, they have to not, it's like, and they need non-targeting, like, banishing or spinning.
Yeah, that is really.
So that's pretty broken. And then it has a graveyard effect. Like, I'd play at least two of those, probably.
Yeah, two, maybe three, I don't know. But
probably. Maybe three side one out if you don't, like, if, depending on the matchup.
Yeah, that's true. I think. The fact that you make your face downs untargetable, because you're probably going to have your shit face down during your opponent's turn anyway, so.
It almost ensures your flip effects will go off, too, because they're not going to pop them.
Yeah, it kind of makes
sense. That's the weakness to a flip effect, is getting, like, I remember in Shadal, like, you always wanted to pop the sets, you never wanted to attack them.
Oh, yeah. Because that's, like, if this deck, if your behemoths get popped, like, you just lose instantly, basically, because they don't have any grave effects.
Yeah, like,
so that definitely helps out with, like, the inherent flaw that most of the effects have.
Yeah,
that is very good. I like the fact that it kind of acts like makes your opponent like more wary about like twin twistering. Like if you just have that set or like maybe like a strike or something, add one too. Like that's kind of cool.
Yeah, I definitely didn't think about that.
It's decent.
It's kind of like almost Sanctum in a way. You don't want to pop the Sanctum, much like you maybe perhaps try avoiding popping this card, because not only does it get you a search, but it also has graveyard utilities like Void Seer and Breakthrough Skill, which is very nice.
Yeah, I like that. I feel like it's like during either player's turn two, maybe. I'm not sure exactly. If you could shit during each player's turn. I'm going to look up Fogblade, because I know you could Fogblade during your player's turn.
Yeah, and if you set it and it gets destroyed and you don't get to use, like, if you like, I'm sure you would chain it, but like even if you didn't get to use the effect somehow, like you'd still have its graveyard effect.
Yeah.
So it doesn't just die from a twin twister. Like, it's just, like, twin twister doesn't render it useless.
Yeah, no, that is a good point, because twin twister is a very relevant card right now.
Yeah, I feel like you could use the trap during either player's turn, too. Like, the grave effect, just like a fog blade, kind of. Just banish it to book one of your things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. I could also see if anybody wanted to go so far as to side a cosmic cyclone. That'd be a good way to get rid of it.
Yeah,
banish
it. Yeah, it'll stop Hidden City, too, and, like, that's a really good
card. Yeah. Like, same thing with Cosmotown.
Uh-huh. I definitely think Cosmic Cyclone's going to be more relevant in the future.
I want to pick some of those up.
I think it's just too good as a card to
be. Is it quick
maybe
play?
Maybe right now. Yeah, it is a quick play. Maybe right good. Now it doesn't have a stage to stand on yet, but I think in the near future, it'll definitely have its place.
Going forward, it'll definitely I hope it rises in price, honestly. I don't have any, but I'm just saying it's just like such a good card that it's kind of weird that it's only like $10 for a cigarette.
Pick them up now. I think I might order them like within a couple of days. Cause,
yeah.
I mean, like, right now, like, destroying spell and traps is great, but, like, if you look at Cosmotown, you destroy it, it replaces itself. If you destroy Fogblade, you just banish it from grave, get an effect. Discard.
Good card to banish with it too.
Hmm?
Metal Foe Counter.
Definitely Metal Foe Counter and the fusion in general. So they.
So like you don't it. Necessarily want some of these meta deck trap cards or spell cards in the graveyard.
Mm-hmm.
Effects, and that's not fun.
Yeah. All right. Well, we'll do a quick little final thoughts on Subterrors. So, Adam, we'll go to you first.
I feel like the deck definitely has potential going forward, of course, but it just needs a little bit more for it to be, like, meta, I feel like. Or, like, at least
extra push.
Yeah, to at least be a tier, like, 1.5 or whatever kind of deck. Yeah, it needs, like, one or two more, like, really good cards before it gets to anything, like, where Cosmo was. But, yeah, it's not a bad deck, and I'm definitely going to be playing it because it's fun as hell, just flipping shit face up and down and booking your opponent's whole field. Like, that's lit.
All right, Dave, your thoughts?
I think it's going to need a stronger turn one, like Adam was saying earlier. Just meta decks nowadays, their turn ones are insane, even if they open average. But I think an advantage it will have before it gets the, you know, in quotes, card it needs, will that... will be that it's
if it ever
a,
does.
It's a tier two, tier three, you know, somewhere in there type of deck. So it's anti-meta, I mean, if you want to call it that.
Yeah.
So it'll have the advantage of being able to stun, or it won't have to deal with that circumstance where, like, meta decks have to worry about each other or meta decks citing certain cards just so that they don't lose to another meta deck. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know. I definitely know what you mean.
So it'll have that going for it. And then if they do get that card, or someone finds out how to break the deck with a card that's already out that no one's thought of, it seems like it could be a 1.5, possibly even 1, depending on what ban lists do to the meta decks. And depending on its price, I'd probably pick it up too, just because it looks like a good...
yeah, it looks like it's a good deck to pick up.
Good option to play, you know, besides the other decks that I have.
Yeah.
As long as that Archer isn't like $30 when it comes out.
Yeah, I hope not. Hidden Cities are like 20-something, I believe.
Yeah.
Lot, but I'm pretty sure the ultras that are out right now are only like $5 a piece, so it's not bad.
Yeah, Stalagmo and Umatrix and Nemesis Warrior, I think, are the three monsters we currently have.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah, so
what is this based off?
I have no idea what it's based off of.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's just it might be a, like a unique archetype. I don't know if Konami's actually come out and said anything about like what it's based off of.
Yeah, I do like the artwork on all the cards, though.
And they look really cool.
Definitely a solid job with that. But yeah, my thoughts, I think it'll be definitely a halfway decent deck once all this war comes out. If I think there's anybody looking for a deck to pick up when INOV releases and they don't want to spend all the money on, you know, ABC, especially with like the extra deck, because it does add up. I know you could buy structure decks, but the money does add up. But depending on the price of, like, Nemesis, it'll definitely be a sleeper deck, and I think it definitely has the chance of somebody like Jeff Jones going to a regional or YCS with this deck, playing it in a way nobody would expect, because nobody's going to know what the cards do, because we've seen this before, where decks go to events, and people are just reading the cards all day, and they end up winning. I think that's what happened with the Volcanics that one year, when they ended up winning that ARG or whatever. It's just a lack of knowledge on their opponent's part, and they just end up losing to it because they don't prepare for it and they don't have side decks for it. So you basically get a free win, you know, game two. They don't got to worry about side deck cards. And I think just as a whole, like, Terrate booking cards and Nemesis Archer, they're just going to add nicely. So that'll conclude our section on the Subterror support. Now we're going to move to Spirals.
Awesome.
The Adam, I know he's excited for these. So this archetype, I believe you said, was based off Metal Gear Solid.
Yeah, I think Konami actually said that this one, well, I don't know if they straight up said it, but it's definitely based off Metal Gear.
Definitely implied. Yeah, that's really cool. Because if you look at Super Agent, I think in the Mission Assault picture, he has a metal arm.
It looks like it.
Or a hand, which I think Snake and one point in the game series has his...
He might.
A metal robot hand, which I'm pretty sure he does, but I could be wrong. But yeah, we have the four cards here. We've got Charming Resort Staff, Spiral Master Plan, and then we have two spell cards consisting of Spiral Resort and Spiral Mission Assault, one being Field Spell, one being Continuous. And we'll go ahead and start with Master Plan.
Big ass.
Yes, sir. So basically... Actually, you know, we'll start with Charming Resort Staff. So basically, when an attack is declared involving a Spiral Super Agent, you control an opponent's face-up monster. You can change the attack of the opponent's monster to zero. If this card is destroyed by battle or card effect, you can special summon one Spiral Super Agent from your deck. If a Spiral Super Agent you control is destroyed by battle or sent to the graveyard while this card is in your graveyard, you can banish this card from your graveyard. Return one Spiral Super Agent from your graveyard to your hand. So it's definitely a handful.
Yeah, there's a lot of effects there. I really like its hand effect. Mm-hmm. Like, I think that's really good. I mean, even though it requires Super Agent to have, I still think you should. It's definitely like good in the deck, and you should definitely play it, even though you really can't search it because it's not a Spiral card. But yeah, that's like honest like effect is really good, and if it gets destroyed, you just special summon your Super Agent to get it real quick, and then if your Super Agent dies, you just add it right back to your hand. Like, that's pretty good.
Yeah, no,
it's got a lot of utility.
Yeah, it's an honest, it's level 3 light. It's definitely a decent card for the deck. And I know for those who play YGO Pro, I think you were having the issue where like this card just will not work for you.
Yeah, every effect works except the honest effect. So, I mean, that's kind of a big deal. But yeah, hopefully YGO Pro gets on their shit and fixes.
Yeah, so if anybody's wanting to try out this deck, just beware that that is an issue.
So, yeah.
All right, but, so definitely a good card. So Spiral Resort, field spell. Your opponent cannot target other Spiral cards you control with card effects.
Immediately
once
good.
Immediately good. Once per turn, you can add one Spiral monster from your deck to your hand. Once per turn during your end phase, shuffle a monster from your grave into the deck or destroy this card. Dave, what do you think?
Really good.
This card is fucking stupid.
It's just another broken field spell.
Yeah.
The only thing they could have added is if this card is destroyed, you can search a Spiral card and add it to your hand.
Make it a Cosmo Town.
Yeah, for real. All
right. It kind of sounds like Union Hanger a bit. Did I hear that right? So it's Union Hanger and Azure Eyes in one.
It also reminds me kind of like a contract for DDD, like the search contract.
Yeah, because it has that, like,
what's return effect, and the cost for it, kind of.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's definitely good.
I really liked also the shuffle effect, just because, like, if you use, like, instant fusion, you can just recycle Norden.
Yeah, that is a good point. I didn't think about that. You can recycle a lot of one-ofs with the card, and they don't have to be Spiral monsters, which is really good.
Yeah, it's really... Well, I mean, it has to be a monster, but I mean...
Yeah, I know it has to be monsters, but, like, if it would have limited it to Spiral monsters, it definitely would lose its value, I think. But
yeah,
any monster, general, like you said, the Norden example is a great example.
It would be nowhere near as good if it needed to shovel a Spiral monster, but just any card, like, hello?
Yeah, one monster from your grave into the deck, and not only do you recycle resources, like, it's just, it gives you so much benefit on top of that.
Yeah, if they don't deal with it, they can't target your Spirals, and you get to search every turn. So this deck does hella searching already, but even more is great.
Yep, searching is definitely a good thing to have in any deck. So next we'll look at Spiral Mission Assault, spell card continuous. Basically, destroy this card during your end phase after activation. Kind of a weird card. Once per turn, if a Spiral monster control destroys a monster by battle, or if you destroy a card or cards in the field with a Spiral monster effect you control, you can draw one card, and you can banish this card from your graveyard, special summon one Spiral monster from your hand. I like this. I mean...
Yeah, like, I don't know.
What is it exactly you don't like about it?
There's no real effects in this deck that, like, destroy anything except Super Agent. He's the only one who's going to do the destroying for you.
So, yeah, I didn't really think about that because, like I said, I'm not too familiar with Spirals like you are, but that is a point you'd want to definitely understand when going to play the deck, so.
Because, like, I mean, yeah, Super Agent could get over a lot with, like, the other support cards the deck has and his own effect with the Pop a Spell Trap, but he's the only one who's going to be destroying stuff, so it's not... I wouldn't play it in more than one or two copies, though. Like, probably just one, honestly.
Yeah, Dave, what do you think about its graveyard utility? Destroy this card during your end phase, and then basically it says you can banish this card from your graveyard, special summon a Spiral monster from your hand. So obviously you wouldn't be able to use that turn if you couldn't destroy it otherwise, so too slow?
I mean, It seems like an extender, but not a superior one.
Yeah.
It'd be better if it summoned one from deck, obviously. Mm-hmm. I mean, looking at the archetype, like, I'm sure Adam knows, but I'm not sure. Like, do these guys synchro XC? Like, how do they, like, attack? Because all their guys look pretty weak. And yeah,
right now, the main way, I think the best way to play the deck is probably, like, a synchro variant.
What are their, do they have their own archetype-specific tuner, or do you just use, Glow Bulb?
You use, like, Glow Bulb and, like, Jet Synchron and all that.
Are they getting a tuner, do you know?
I don't know. Not this set.
I was going to say, because, like, I mean, they don't look like they have their deck head. Like, the deck by itself doesn't have a ton of power.
No, definitely doesn't.
It's not like Blue Eyes where, like, if you don't make a synchro, you still got 3K sticks that can pop and banish. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I feel that.
I mean, if they got cards that could readily pop and destroy stuff and easily run over stuff with, you know, not too much hassle, I'd probably play this card. But without that, maybe a one of or a none of, depending.
Yeah, definitely. I don't think it deserves a spot as a three of. I think we can all agree on that.
Yeah, definitely one of though because of Master Plan.
Mm-hmm. All right, now we'll look at Master Plan.
Yes.
Once per turn, you can add one Spiral Mission card from your deck to your hand. If this card is sent from the field to the graveyard, you can add one Spiral Resort and one Spiral Monster from your deck to your hand, except Spiral Master Plan. You can only use this effect of Spiral Master Plan once per turn. So what I'm seeing here is a double search and then another search on top of that.
Yeah, she searches everything. She
searches a lot.
That's why you should at least play one mission just so you can search it with her effect. Because, I mean, it's the only thing you could search right now with it, so, like, you'd probably play it.
Yeah, you get a free Spiral Resort and a Spiral Monster
when she sends it
from the field to the graveyard.
Which isn't that hard to do, because, I mean, you want to synchro with this deck, so you're probably going to go into, like, a level 8 with her and a level 1.
Yeah, level 7, 1200 attack, 2800 defense. I mean, that's a pretty solid card. And it's a dark. Is there any other darks in the deck?
No, they're all different types, like Drone. Actually, they're mostly Earths, except the Charmin Resort Staff. Yeah,
Resort Staff is a light, and Master Plan is dark, because Dave is probably thinking there are DDDs, and any dark deck, you get those Allure of Darknesses in there, you're going to have a good time.
Yeah.
You could typically play a Spiral Dark Magician, because she's a dark spellcaster, but I feel like that'd be kind of bad.
That is an interesting idea. No, I didn't think of that. But whether or not it'd be viable or not is another question, but
that's true.
Overall, that is the new support for INOV for Spirals. Last thoughts, Adam?
One more thing about Master Plan is, like, if you, like, discard her off of, like, a discard card, I don't know, for example, like, one for one or something.
Yep.
You can just reborn her with the big red, the spell, and you just bring her back for free, essentially, and get your Spiral Mission search, and then just sync her up, and then just get her other search effects.
That's definitely a good combo.
Yeah, Big Red is, like, probably one of the deck's best cards right now. Like just a monster reborn once per turn.
Yeah, it's like a premature burial, right?
Yeah, it's an equip.
Yeah.
So, and other than last thoughts, like, this deck, again, it doesn't really have, like, much power to it. Like, you need to synchro with it in order to win.
Uh-huh.
But hopefully, just like Subterrors, hopefully gets more support so it can actually be viable in the meta.
Mm-hmm.
But other than that, like, it's just, like, a fun synchro deck. I mean, you could pull out some cool plays with it, just, like, probably some, like, Crystal Wing, Zulkin type plays, but yeah, other than that, it's not too powerful, but still a fun, decent deck nonetheless.
Dave?
I feel like this deck needs Contact Fusion. I feel like, unless they got, like, an archetype tuner and, like, a way to readily access it, like, consistently, kind of like a Lamia.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I think Contact Fusion would be a good way to solve this deck's problem.
Yeah, you know what? You're right.
Obviously, because there'd be
you're right, and I don't mean to interrupt, but, like, you're right because there is no tuner as of right now, and there is no... They all have, like, varying levels, so you can't...
Yeah, so Ixie's not.
Ixie's.
Yeah.
So I feel like you bring up a good point there, saying a Spiral Fusion in a Contact Fusion form would definitely help out a lot, or even a tuner. Continue.
Or a Fusion spell.
Yeah.
Like a mission spell, except it's a fusion card or something.
Yeah, kind of like El Shaddoll.
Yeah.
Did you have anything else to add?
I like the deck, I don't like it as much as Subterror. I don't know if I would play it as readily as Subterror, but overall it seems decent. It just needs a lot more than it what it has.
Yeah, I definitely agree. So pretty much for my thoughts, definitely does need more power in the extra deck, because on its own it doesn't do a whole lot other than search, and then you have to rely on outside resources to make that aren't your spiral cards, so not searchable to an extent to make extra deck plays. So definitely needs a little more than Subterrors, though.
Yeah, definitely more than Subterrors, because Subterrors just need at least one card. This card needs this deck needs at least two or three more to be.
It needs some help.
Viable.
Yeah, needs help. I think that we can all agree on as well. So move on now.
What's the next topic of discussion?
Moving away from archetypes, new support, and we're gonna go into something that we can all talk about with confidence, which is ABC has officially joined the TCG meta in the Kaiba structure deck. And how do you guys think it's gonna handle over here, and what do you think it's gonna end up doing in the future? We'll go to Adam first.
I mean, it's already a really good deck. It came out the gates swinging, definitely up there. Tier 1, obviously. It's already taken multiple regionals, topping. And I feel like going forward, it's still going to be pretty powerful. And I feel like they're definitely not going to hit it anytime soon.
Uh-huh.
It's going to take at least, 6 months to, maybe even a year before they hit the deck, just like Monarchs. But yeah, the shit it could do, abusing rank fours, and, if you play the Galaxy Soldier build, just dropping Infinity with a Buster Dragon, just makes some really hard-to-crack boards and backs up with traps, and just, I feel like it's just super strong, and Metal Foe and, Blue Eyes are really the only decks that could keep up with it, in my opinion.
Yeah, so that is a good point, a lot of people, I feel, don't give the deck the credit it deserves, because I think a lot of people are skeptical. I know I kind of am a little bit, but I'm starting to see it more and more now as time goes on. It is, in a sense, a linear deck. You know, it's rank 4 and then ABC, Buster Dragon, but that alone is strong, you know. The fact that it is linear, but it is very strong in what it does in that sense.
Yeah, it is somewhat of a glass cannon, I would say, too, because if you just drop a Gamma Seal over a Buster Dragon or just, a Veiler, their gadget, their plays just end, usually. Yeah. So
there are definitely key points that'll end up stopping the deck in its tracks. You say Gamma Seal and Effect Veiler, and that's, I think, why people are playing that Magnet Reverse card to lessen the impact of getting a Gamma Seal dropped on your head. So Dave, what do you think of ABCs right now?
I think it is a tier 1 deck, obviously. Everyone could see that coming, especially from what it was doing in the OSG for the past couple months. But I don't think it did what Necroz did. When Necroz entered, it immediately was the best deck by far. I think the first YCS that happened after that, the top 32, I think 27 of them were Necroz, and then the other couple spots were scattered other decks.
Mm-hmm.
This deck wouldn't do something like that, I don't feel, at a YCS or the next one. I think Blue Eyes and Metal Foe and even BAPK or variants would take up more spots. So I think it's tier 1, but I don't think it's an explosive tier 1. At least not on the level of Necroz or a full force Dragon Ruler deck.
Yeah, definitely.
It is susceptible to brick hands, and when this deck does brick, it sometimes is almost unplayable.
Yeah.
But Blue Eyes, another, tier 1 meta deck, can do the same thing.
Yeah.
I think it's slightly more consistent than Blue Eyes on average, just because, Union Hanger and the Terraformings, and Union Hanger gets you started pretty easily. Blue Eyes doesn't really have a field spell that can search like that.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that it can play Instant Fusion, it has that over a lot of decks,
mm-hmm.
And it plays it really well. And usually when you can get instant fusion off in this deck, it ends up going from like Tsukiyomi Buster to like a Gigant, and Gigant can search.
Or a Diamond Direwolf, and Diamond Direwolf has made a huge presence in this deck. I mean, card prices for Diamond Dire, Secret Rares, I think, are upwards of 20, and a lot of people are playing two Diamond Dire in their extra decks, I'm pretty sure. It's so good.
It's a free pop, and then you just get a free Buster Dragon, essentially.
Yeah, put all your pieces in the grave, especially if you make it with two or more.
Clear problem and just go off then.
Yeah. Now, obviously, we know that the deck has, I said it was linear at the start of this, but I kind of want to draw back on that. When I say that, is...
You know what's linear?
What?
You just go A, B, C, plus gadget sometimes, and make Buster Dragon, and then repeat.
Yeah, but...
It's linear the way it stands now. Maybe in the future when someone breaks the deck, or it gets hit and it needs to do other stuff, it won't be as linear, but it's pretty much Tsukiyomi Buster, and if you open good, you get, like, a Gigant or something.
You get an extra rank 4 or something. Like that.
That's, like, the most broke play you can open is double rank 4 Buster.
Yeah. But the one thing I wanted to get at, to kind of poke at my linear comment I made, is we are seeing different ways to play the deck. Obviously, we have Pure with just your Thrashers, your Gadgets. Whether or not you want to play them at 2 or 3, which we'll get to that in a moment. And then we have our Galaxy Soldier, and we have Transmodify. And we also have cards like Jumbo Drill and Magnet Reverse, which people are also playing. And other tech choices, which one that I personally gamble, which is Photon Lead, which summons a level 4 light monster from your hand, quick play. So I think there are other ways to play the deck, but do you guys think, asking both of you, is there going to be one way that you think people are going to conform to? Or do you think it's going to stay either Pure or Galaxy Soldier Engine, like a more of a one-sided thing? Adam, we'll start with you.
I feel like we just have to see where the meta goes, honestly, because I feel like right now, I feel like people are just going to play, like, varied variants of the deck, like the Galaxy Soldier and, like, Rank 4. I don't know about equally. Like, I feel like there's definitely going to be more Pure Rank 4 versions of the deck, or, like, just playing Jumbo Drill instead of the Galaxy Soldiers. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I really can't say for sure which variant will be more prevalent. Mm-hmm. I also saw people trying Brilliant Fusion out in this deck, and I haven't really seen much of it, but I feel like...
Yeah, I definitely think Brilliant Fusion could be really, really good in this deck.
Yeah, I don't know why not many people are trying it. I guess people just haven't because of Garnet bricking or something. I really don't know, though, but...
For Brilliant Fusion, that's the one thing that always keeps me from playing it in Blue Eyes, because, like, in Blue Eyes, if you open the Brilliant Fusion combo, you usually just open, like, crazily good. It looks like you open Soul Charge, but, like, the reason I don't play it is because if you open your Lazuli or a Garnet or whatever you're playing, you just have, like, 6 dead cards in your deck, and your hand's dead, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's one reason I think not a lot of people play that, but as far as, like, Pure versus Galaxy Soldier, I think the this is what I think, but it's hard to say. I think the majority of the people would probably stick to the Pure just because it is slightly more consistent. And if you're looking to win big tournaments, you want to have as consistent as the deck as possible. Yeah. But it really depends on whether you like, Infinity or not. That's, it's kind of like a 50-50.
And I think another thing that comes out with that being said is, like you said, you have your rank 4, and you can obviously devote a lot more space in your extra deck without the Infinity package. And you already have the Utopia package, which I think is a necessary evil in the deck. Not that it's a necessary evil, but I feel like it is needed against Blue Eyes to a certain extent, because you do need that 5,000 beater. But actually devoting the space, the extra deck space can be a little tight in there, because obviously you need triple Buster Dragon and you need the Utopia package. But
personal story with the deck quick.
And Galaxy Soldier can, de-brick your hand, get you an Infinity. Transmodified obviously helps speed that up, but I think a lot of people would argue, is the risk worth the reward, because it can be stopped pretty easily, being able to stop a Galaxy Soldier with an Effect Veiler or something. And I think a lot of people underestimate Veiler this format. I think ABC should in my opinion, make Valor a much more playable card. What do you guys think? Adam, we'll start with you.
Valor, I feel like this format is, I don't even know, decent. Like, you need to see it, like, first turn, like, obviously.
Like, Blue Eyes could search it, obviously. I
mean, yeah, you could search it in Blue Eyes, but it really only hits, like, gadgets.
Well, it does also hit the rank 4s, which I think is another big thing. Because if you can Valor a Tsukiyomi, I don't know if Tsukiyomi makes you discard for cost, but being able to Valor a Tsukiyomi, I think, would be pretty rough.
I don't think it does.
No, yeah, I don't. I mean, yeah, if you detach, then yeah, I don't think you would have to. Or just
it says and if you do.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes. That's not the case. Going back to the Utopia, like how you said it was like a necessary evil, but not really like an evil type thing. Yeah. But the deck definitely needs it because personal story at locals, I got a Chaos Max dropped on me after I used my Utopia package and I lost.
I remember that.
Because the deck doesn't get over Chaos Max.
So that deck has a problem with beaters, and I know this for trains, especially going first, they have a hard time dealing with number 81, 4,000 defense, and if they try to get rid of the Buster Dragon, you can just obviously use Spectre to protect itself.
Yeah.
And then, of course, they could tag out into the smaller pieces, but they can't do anything to 4,000 defense. Dave, you were going to say something?
The whole Valor thing, I mean, Valor is good, but it honestly, like, and this might be just an easy answer, but it depends on the deck you're playing. Like, I think it is probably better against ABC than things like, obviously, Magic Spectre can't be targeted. In the Blue Eyes Mirror, once they get Azure Eyes, you know, Valor's dead for two turns. Burning Abyss, you know, Dante Mills for cost. If you hit the Break Sword, it's good, but that's about it. In my experience playing ABC, and I've only done test hands, I really haven't played in, like, tournaments yet, but, like, Valoring the gadget sometimes just shuts down the entire turn.
Yeah, yeah.
If they have the Photon Thrasher play, then Valor's not as good. You obviously can still negate their rank 4, but that leaves it more likely for them to have a follow-up. But, like, probably 50% to 70% of the test hands I do, like, you open the gadget and you're like, all right, so gadget, peace, Tsukiyomi, you know, ditch, search, or, you know, send, draw, get traps and all that.
Yeah.
So if you stop that gadget, a lot of times that it's shuts down
a lot of, where, you know, further play. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, usually, I mean, usually it's like gadget, Valor, all right, set a trap, pass. Usually that's how it's been. Like, if it did get Valored, that's what it would be. Mm-hmm.
And I guess now that we're kind of talking about hand traps, I heard a while ago somebody talking, I overheard them, somebody was complaining about Strike, as people will do, complaining about the card because they get salty or whatever, losing to it. But I honestly think we're getting to the point where hand traps are arguably coming some of the best cards in the game, and since Strike can stop them, I think Strike will need to stay at relatively probably 2 or 3 for a while, because I think I said this at one point, Max C as a card on its own is insane. I mean, if you cannot guarantee game through a Max C, you are essentially handing your opponent the win. There are some decks that once they get max seed, they have to stop. And I think a lot of people have never really looked at it this way, but if you're getting max seed and you have to stop, like, you literally cannot play cards, not because you don't have resources to do so, is because if you keep going and you can't guarantee game, especially on a turn one board, you're really just going to pay for it, you know, the turn or two later. So I think hand traps are definitely important, and I want to see what your guys' thoughts and opinions with Strike and hand traps are. And Dave, we'll start with you.
Max C, it sometimes is almost as strong as Vanity's Emptiness, or almost can act like it. Obviously, against Max C, you have a choice, whereas Vanity's, you know, if you don't have an out, you don't have the choice, so you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Depending on what deck you're playing, for example, against Mermail, and it depends on what deck you're playing.
Yeah.
So you're going against Mermail or, you know, Metal Foe or whatever, and they max C you.
Like, ABC can go off on Special Summoning Tangent.
I mean, if you can't make a board that's going to fend off your opponent having 8 to 10 cards, then you lose anyway. So basically, you either stop and your opponent kills you because you didn't do anything, or you go off, make a crazy board, and it doesn't matter because you gave your opponent enough cards to crack it anyway.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how I look at it. Obviously, there's some decks like Blue Eyes where if you don't know they're playing it, you're not going to get the draw-off alternative. And then they can synchro one. You'll get one draw, and they can pass because, you know, spirit and defense is pretty much a good turn for Blue Eyes.
It's just a one-for-one at that point.
Yeah, but, I mean, there are certain decks where if Maxi is thrown, you basically decide, do I pass and they kill me, or do I give them enough cards to break whatever field I make and kill me anyway? So sometimes it's like, do I lose or do I lose?
Yeah, that's essentially what Maxi has become. Adam, what do you think about this?
Yeah, I feel like most of the decks, like, aside ABC right now and like BA, they can just stop after they special summon once. Like Blue Eyes and like Metal Foe just need a pendulum. Any
pendulum variant.
Yeah.
Yeah, the pendulum, then they can just sit on their pendulums for like a turn. But yeah. I feel, if you drop a Maxi, if your hand is at least decent, you're probably winning the game.
Mm-hmm.
Just because they'll have to stop, because, or unless they're crazy and just want to give you all the cards. And just, like, make a,
happen.
Like, I don't know, it's hard to say, like.
Yeah, because then, like, even if they, like, draw a, let's say, like, they got five cards and you give them three draws. If they end up drawing, like, a bonus Raigeki, that just gives them one free thing to throw at you that baits out that crucial negation you needed to stop their turn, and now they're free to play.
Yeah, that's
Strike is definitely necessary against, like, shit like that, but, I mean, I know you can't, like, set Strike first turn. Turn one, but
I think that's one of the best things that Strike offers as like a solemn counter trap is it's not just like monster effects, or I shouldn't say monster effects, but just special summoning conditions, which we've seen with like most of the solemn cards, warning being the one in particular. It can stop effects anywhere, I think it's definitely pivotal to help stop hand traps. But I think that'll wrap up our discussion with ABC and with it entering into the meta. And our general thoughts of that, and we'll go into our next topic for today, which is Invasion Vengeance is releasing very, very soon, and I think it might be in within the next 2 weeks or so. Am I wrong, or?
I think this weekend is the sneak peek, and then the following week it comes out.
Yeah, so it looks like maybe possibly within 2 weeks or so. We got Tree Toad, we've got Dimensional Barrier, we've got Parrot Seahorse, Star Venom, Fusion Dragon, just to name a few. We all know what Tree Toad does, and it is confirmed secret rare, by some leaks, I believe, that we have on the YGO.org. And I guess for this section, we could probably just talk about Tree Toad, secret rare. I want you guys to throw a price at me, and Dave, we'll start with you since you're very well acclimated with your card prices with your ridiculous trade binder. You know, DT Trish, 2 Ulti Trish, 3 Ulti Maxi, 3 Ulti Mailer. And yes, that is actually his front page, so think whatever you want to think about it. Give me your day one sneak peek price for Tree Toad being a secret rare. Right now, obviously thinking about it, its only utility would be obviously giving a huge spike for heroes and Mermail as well.
Definitely. Yeah, I mean, that's going to be why it's not like $200, because like ABC, Blue Eyes, Metal Foe, they can't like readily play it. Obviously, you could play, you know, 10 Goldfish and Bubble Man and ABC if you wanted to do that. You could pendulum summon out this stuff, but like, you know, looking at it for what it is, I could see it maybe like a $50 secret. Starting out and then maybe settling at like 20 to 30.
Yeah.
Unless ABC or Pendulum or Blue Eyes find ways to, you know, always make Tree Toad, really it's heroes, Mermail.
That's pretty much it, honestly.
Any other rogue deck that can make it, like Dynamis. Paleozoics can make it too.
Oh, yeah, Paleozoics, yeah. You can just don't need Bahamut Shark. Let's remember that. You can always use two level twos. Like, you can even go D.Va into infantry and make it that way. Which is why I personally think for my Mermail build, I'll be playing one Bahamut and probably two Toad.
Don't you need two Aquas, though, to make it?
I don't think so.
Yeah, level two Aqua type monster.
Two Aquas, well, then there you go. You could use two infantry if that ever ends up occurring.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you could go D.Va into infantry, then normal summon another infantry and make Trito that way, but that's kind of out of the question. Anyways, back to what we were talking about. Adam, give me a day one sneak peek price for Trito.
I think it's going to definitely, like what Dave said, like around 50. Like, I can't imagine getting any higher just because no other decks aside, those are really going to play it. And it's just, I mean, people are going to want to pick it up for, like, the cherries.
Yep.
But other than that, I definitely don't see it going anywhere higher than 50. And it's definitely going to sell around, like, 30, I feel like.
Yeah,
and
I definitely think that's a good call for price range.
Like, it's not going to be, like, Solemn Strike or, like, a Pendulum Sorcerer when they first came out of Bosh. Mm-hmm. Are those cards 70, 80 a piece?
Yeah, because Tree Toad is not archetype specific, but it is, whereas Strike can be played in anything.
Yeah. And like in the Bosch format, like the Pepe being the best, like, tier, like, zero broken deck, like, why the Pendulum deck was so broken, just because of Pendulum Sorcerer and, like, all the other support cards that were out of the time with it.
Mm-hmm.
And Tree Toad isn't breaking any deck like that, so.
Yeah, it's just not right.
As expensive as like that card would have been first coming out.
And next we've got Dimension Barrier as a trap card. I was looking at this card a while back. And it's a secret rare confirmed for INOV, at least to our knowledge and understanding at the moment. Basically, normal trap card, declare one monster card, Ritual, Fusion, Synchro, Ixie, or Pendulum. This turn, neither player can special summon monsters of the declared type. Also negate the effects of face-up monsters on the field of the declared type while they are on the field. And you can only activate one Dimension Barrier per turn, so no activating three and calling Synchro, Fusion, Ixies, and or Pendulum. So, Dave, thoughts?
Is this the Secret Rare?
This is the Secret Rare trap card, yeah.
This, I could see being $80.
$80?
This, I mean, I don't know if it would, I don't know if it'll stay there, but I could see it getting up to it. Kind of like Dante's, how they went up to 100 and then rode back down slowly. This is like a Vanity's Emptiness to certain decks. I mean, what does it say? Neither player can special summon monsters of their own type. So, you play against Metal Foe or a Pendulum deck, what are they going to do? Normal summon Bumbuku Pass? Like, they're not going to be able to do, you know, any major plays. Maybe they can get a Kieran out somehow.
Yeah,
but
and it's not a continuous, because like if you go first, it's obviously going to be a side deck card, but you go first, you activate it. Once it's gone, it goes to the grave. They don't got to worry about Twin Twister, because you can chain it. You know, it's definitely an instant play
and
stopper.
And let's say you're playing against Herald. You call Ritual. What are they going to do?
Not going to do much. I mean, obviously, they could probably make Ixie's plays.
Ouroboros Pass, they lose.
Yeah, because Herald is their strongest axis. Yeah,
you just pop the Ouroboros and, you know, make a board and basically swing in for game.
And perhaps set another one for next turn and even block them out. Adam, what do you think?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think it's going to be 80, just because I feel like Strike is still a card. I feel like if Strike were to for some reason get hit or something, this card rise in price is like almost a replacement for it.
Yeah.
Strike essentially does the same thing as Strike.
It's just not a counter trap.
Summoning, yeah, you're stopping.
Yeah, because Dave, you did bring up the fact. Sorry to interrupt, but you did bring up the fact that you say like normal Bumbuku Pass, but it also negates the effects of those monsters on the field, so they wouldn't be able to.
True, and it doesn't target.
Yeah. Adam, so continue with what you were saying.
Yeah, I feel like it's definitely not going to be that expensive unless Strike were to somehow like get randomly hit down to like one or like none or whatever, but.
Mm-hmm.
I could definitely see it being sided like against a lot of decks, and like I could see it being like a staple side deck card even.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah. I could easily see it being a 3-up.
Yeah, I feel like it would settle around somewhere like $50, like Tree Toad would. Not $50, like start at 50 and like get lower as like time went on, obviously. But yeah, I can't say for sure with this one, just because we just need to see like where the game is gonna go with like
this card. I think this card. If you activate it and call Ixie, because they can't special summon Ixies, obviously, or it negates the effects.
You also think about, like, if you activate this against ABC and you call Fusion, no Buster Dragon for them.
That's true, yeah.
Not even that. Like, usually, like, how often would you say they make Buster Dragon turn one without making an Ixie first?
Not that often.
So you could even just call Ixie and then, like, they just do nothing, because the like if you call fusion, like they'll still make like an XE, but like 95% of the time, unless they open something weird that I've never heard of, they need to make an XE first, whether it's Diamond Dyer or Tsukiyomi. So you just call XE. They don't make an XC or a fusion because they can't make the fusion without the XC, and then they pass in with a gadget on field, and you just kill them.
Yeah, that's a good point because oftentimes they have to go Tsukiyomi first, get their pieces like, in the grave, and then make.
Buster. I don't think that can you even open a hand without making an XC and make Buster Dragon? Is there a way to do that? Like I don't think there's a way to do that.
There.
It's got to be like super rare.
There is like you could. It'd be really hard because you
Photon
could, like,
get... Photon Thrasher into a letter, and then you get one off the field spell.
But they got... They're in your hand.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, so what I mean? You just call XC.
You get two on field, normal summon, attached from deck. And then, like, some... You might have, like, a discard outlet or something, like, in your hand, like a Twin Twister to get the other one. Yeah.
You'd have to burn it.
That'd be the only way they can make Buster Dragon turn one without an XC.
Yeah, that's a good point. Never really thought about needing an XC to actually make Buster Dragon first turn or, like you said, discard outlet. That's definitely a good point.
Yeah, I mean, basically, you're going to be dealing with one gadget and maybe a set trap or so, and, you know, most meta decks can handle that or deal with that.
Yeah.
So, I mean, this card can effectively be used to just shut off ABC if you open it.
Yeah, definitely. And,
my
priced... standpoint, I think I'd probably to start off with I would probably have to disagree with both of you, and I'm gonna go lower. I think it'll probably start off at $20 a copy and rise from there to how much I don't know. Go ahead, Dave.
It's definitely not gonna be lower than 20, I don't think.
Because I think it'll be one of those cards where it'll come out, people are like, oh, that's the secret rare trap card. And then people, weeks later, be like, wow, this card is really, really good.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people did that with Lust of Pendulum, too, and Galaxy Cyclone and Archphoenix Centric.
So you think it's going to do kind of like a Desires and how it started at, like, 50 and then just continually rose to, like, 80?
I think it will, so long as it sees play, which I definitely think it'll see play. There's no way this card's not going to see play. It's an amazing side deck card.
This is really good.
And this lets anti-meta decks get a good grip, too.
Yeah, that's definitely a good point. All right, next we'll look at Parent Seahorse. This card is weird. You guys see this artwork? It looks like a peanut.
It looks like a peanut.
With like a dragon head on it. It
looks kind of scary, honestly.
I know it says it came out in Cross here, but that's probably when it came out in the OCG.
Yeah.
But it's coming out in INOV for us. So it is a level 7 water. Worm Tuner effect monster. It cannot be special summoned except by a worm type monster's effect. During your main phase, you can reduce the level of this card by 1. And if you do, special summon 1 seahorse token. Worm type water level 1, attack 300, defense 200. You can only affect a parent seahorse up to thrice per turn. Haven't seen the word thrice on a card in a while. I think Coach King Giant Trainer is the only other one I think I've seen that says thrice per turn. So basically this thing, as Adam says, it shits out tokens for synchro plays like crazy. I think you said Yang Xing is going to be playing it, and I think we're definitely going to see a resurgence of Yang Xing. Not that Metal Foe Yang Xing is already a thing. We kind of saw a little bit of a rebirth there.
But
with a new trap card too, so yeah, the new nine tails or whatever, the Yang Xing.
Coming out this set for Yang Xings.
Yeah.
Like, they're definitely going to see more play because the synchro is busted, like...
A new Yang Xing synchro?
Yeah, it's like, I'm pretty sure it's also a tuner synchro.
Uh-huh.
And it has like a surge effect too with it, and I'm pretty sure it's really good. I don't know much about it, though.
Do you have a way to look it up on YGO Pro real quick?
Yeah, I got you.
All right. Do we know what rarity this card's going to be?
I think that's just going to be a common, but I know the Yang Xing Synchro is going to be an Ultra, I believe.
Mm-hmm. I think this card will be pretty cheap off the bat if it's common, but
yeah, it'll be super
cheap.
It's
going to have great utilities for Yang Xing.
Is this just a one card level 7 Synchro?
It's a one card level 7, 6, or 5 synchro, I believe. Yeah, depending on how you want to use the tokens and like how you want to use the tuner. Because you could have all plays with it, too. But yeah, I got Deng Long here. You want me to read him real quick or something?
Yeah, go ahead, read it off.
All right, yeah, it's a level 5 Synchro Effect Tuner Light Worm. It's got a 0 attack, 2800 defense, and it's generic. No specific tuners or non-tuners or anything like that. And if this card is special summon, you can add one Yang Zing card from your deck to your hand. Once per turn, you can send one worm type from your deck to the graveyard. This card's level becomes the same level as the sent monsters. And if this face-up card leaves the field, you can special summon one Yang Zing monster from your deck. You can only special summon Deng Long once per turn.
That is a really good
card.
Yeah, I
like that name.
Deng Long. That's an interesting
card. I'm
playing
some Yang Zing.
Searches, sends, like, hello? This is broke. I know a lot of Yang Zing players are waiting for this card to come out, so you can just do some crazy combos, I'm sure, with it.
Huh.
But I haven't really looked into it that much, honestly, because I'm not really that big into Yang Zings. I'm really not a fan of the deck, but I can definitely see it's really good and that it might give Yang Zings a little boost. I don't know how strong they'll be, though, compared to, like, ABC or something like that, but...
Is it you said it was a level 5 light?
Yeah, level 5 light worm.
And it's a tuner. I think it's called Wang Tain Hao Origin of the Yang Zing on... the wiki.
Oh, really?
Make sure it's the same one.
Let me pull up the...
Kind of looks like a giant Yang Zing. Sort of. It's got four legs. It's
yeah.
Gold. Zero attack, 2800 defense. Yeah, this is the one you're talking about.
Down here. On the...
I
just
want to make sure we're on the same page.
How do you spell the Synchro's name?
Dengllong.
Right,
yeah, it's called Deng Long. Like
Deng Long Origin of the Yang Zing. It seems pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah,
huh.
It's definitely an interesting card. Parent Seahorse is going to help out a lot with Yang Zing.
I think that the whole Worm archetype needs...
I think Worms could be busted in the future.
It needs more.
They're getting the Worm Rulers, too. Like, those cards are sick.
What are they?
What are they?
The Worm Rulers, like the Water one and the Fire one that we already got. And I know The next set after this, we're getting the Earth one.
Huh. No, it seems like the only thing that's ever been done for it, really, is Yang Zing.
Yeah, we haven't seen too much stuff Worm-related other than Yang Zing, and I think Konami is going to drop the bomb one of these days on a Worm deck.
And Tier 1
broke.
It's going
to be retarded, just because it's a one-of-a-kind. Like, there are so few Worms in the game.
I think right now... I think, like, up, you know, from the time Worms were released to the time that deck comes, I feel like there's a bunch of cards nobody sees as good now that are just these little seeds floating around. And when that broke deck comes out, all of a sudden these rares and these, you know, dollar commons, there's going to be one or two of them out there that are three of us that just make it broken.
Yeah, no, you're definitely not wrong. There's
kind of like
Oasis. A time bomb on this. Yeah. Oasis is one of those cards, too.
Supports, yeah.
Another card that I've pulled up here is Starve Venom Fusion Dragon.
Oh, yeah, the cover card?
Yeah, the cover card. We might as well talk about it since it's on the pack cover. I know sometimes the pack cover card has been hit or miss sometimes. I think Crystal Wing was one. Obviously, that was not a miss. Definitely a hit. And
yeah.
If you want to pull up Starve Venom real quick, I have it pulled up here, but
yeah,
I just want to make sure it's the correct effect.
Yeah. You want me to read something, or?
I just want to make sure. Just tell me if I'm wrong or not. Needs two non-token dark monsters.
Sounds right so far.
Field. If this card is fusion summoned, you can make this card gain attack equal to the attack of the one special monster your opponent controls until the end of this turn.
Yep.
Okay, then once per turn, you can target one level 5 or higher monster your opponent controls. Until the end of the turn, this card's name becomes that monster and replace this effect with that monster's original effect. If this fusion summon card is destroyed, you can destroy all special summon monsters your opponent controls. Thoughts? Dave, we'll start with you.
Well, that last effect seemed pretty good. What is its attack? I don't have it pulled up here.
2800 attack, 2000 defense, level 7 dark fusion dragon.
Dark.
Level what
8,
does it report?
Huh? It's a level 8, my bad. I said it was a 7. It needs two non-token dark monsters on the field.
And is it just a contact?
No, it's poly.
Yeah, so you need poly, or some sort of fusion.
So you need polymerization?
Or you
or
need
something
a fusion.
Like it.
Yeah, you need a fusion to make it.
I mean, it seems all right. Is there a deck that's going to be playing this exclusively?
I have no idea.
You could play it in, like, any dark deck with poly. So, like, I think maybe Fluffle. Actually, I don't know if any Fluffles
are dark. You can use Shadals pretty well with this.
Yeah, you could use it in Shadals. I know Predator Plants are coming out that I think they're going to play this card.
Mm-hmm.
Arcs
and... I mean, it seems good, but it doesn't seem like a Crystal Wing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And doesn't seem super splashable, kind of like Crystal Wing. You know, Crystal Wing's pretty splashable, and yeah, some decks even modify decks their own deck to play it.
Yeah, Zulkin is a thing.
Yeah, it seems all right.
Adam?
Yeah, I think it's going to be decent. Definitely no Crystal Wing, but I feel like it's definitely powerful. I think it's targeting, if it didn't target, it'd be a little bit better, but yeah, taking a monster's effect, like, you could take a Crystal Wing effect with this if you, like, negate it somehow first.
Yeah.
And this becomes Crystal Wing.
Yeah, that is a good point. Or even a Zulkin.
Yeah, you could just take a Zulkin effect if you could target it or something like that. I feel like there's some, like, weird obscure combo you could do with this card in, like, a crazy, like, dark synchro type deck or something like that.
Yeah, definitely.
I know why they made it two non-tokens.
Could you just make it with Gofu token?
Gofu is a dragon. Big fucking card right now. Gofu is everywhere.
Yeah, I would totally play Poly and Metal Foe if you could just use Gofu tokens for this thing.
Yep.
Yeah.
That'd be so...
Yeah. Do you guys see at the moment any deck that can openly play this card? I personally don't. Adam, what do you think?
I think.
Go ahead.
Predator Plant deck, like, it's a new deck. Obviously, I'm pretty sure it comes out this set.
Comes out in and of.
Yeah, the Predator Plant deck. Because I'm pretty sure, like, the dude, like, in the anime plays, like, this card in his Predator Plant decks, and, like, they have some sort of synergy.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, yeah, there's really no, like, deck out right now that could actually just straight up play it, unless you're playing, like, Poly and, like, some dark, like, synchro or, like, Shadal / combo or something. But
Dave,
so you're asking me if there's a deck that can play this card?
Yeah, I mean, he brought up the what were those plants called?
The Predator Plant.
Predator Plants. Yeah. Besides Predator Plants, do you see any decks?
I don't think there's any deck that can just easily say, like, oh, we play, you know, two or three of these.
Yeah.
But I think if you mod the deck a bit, DDD could play this deck.
You know what? Never thought of that.
Because it just needs two Dark Monsters, so I'm thinking you could play, like, a Rota with possibly, like, an Elemental Hero Blazeman, because it searches Poly when it's summoned.
Mm-hmm.
I know that there's, at, you know, our locals that we were on Friday, the last cat I played, he was playing Shadal with
Kaijus. Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, Shadal Kaijus. He was playing Blazeman, and he used it to search the Poly.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking, and, you know, obviously a deck like that, because, you know, all DDDs are dark, so you never have to worry about not having Dark Monsters.
And you can get Dark Monsters on the field pretty fast, because it does require two Dark Monsters that are on the field, so unfortunately you can't fuse from hand. Or else, if you could fuse from hand with this card, it'd be leaps and bounds better than it could be.
I mean... You open double slime in DDD, and you have two Dark Monsters.
Yeah.
That's true.
And then you just need Poly.
Yeah, and depending on what they have on their field for an effect to steal, obviously it'd make it even better.
Yeah.
I think you could even play this in, like, BA or, like, Phantom Knights.
I didn't even think about BA.
You definitely could.
I'm thinking, what dark deck is out right now that you can play this in a fucking Burning Abyss?
With especially with BA... Like, if you, let's say you, like, special, like, you know, Graf Seer, and then you Poly, you'd get Graf and Seer's effects, too, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I mean, the shit you summon off of them would die unless it's, like, a Dante or, like, a...
Yeah, I mean, you could always, like, end phase Skarm.
Dante and Virgil summon off it, I mean.
Yeah, I feel like you could definitely play this in, like, you just, like, tech a Poly in BA and just, like, play this in BA. And, like,
yeah, and if it comes up, it comes up, steal something. And if it dies,
kinda like, it's kind of like playing Mass steal. Change in BA. If it happens, it happens.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. I feel like... I feel like this card could be strong in BA. I kind of want to try that now, honestly.
Going to open up some ideas for some tech choices. But that is our thoughts on Starve Venom Fusion Dragon. I really like the name and the artwork. Definitely.
Yeah, that's
really cool. Looks really cool. And now we're going to go to, I think at this point, our market talk. We'll try to make it quick because we're coming up. I think we're a little over the hour mark now. which we're going to try to land it around to an hour half or so.
Yeah, no, it's a good length.
Yeah. Market talk. There's a few cards that I want to bring up. If we missed anything, oh well. This is our first time doing this. Market talk. We're going to look at Solemn Strike and Magnet Reverse being Let's some see. Of the most, more expensive cards right now that are on the rise. And I guess we'll look at Omega, too. I know he's on the screen here. Omega being an expensive card, continually being an expensive card. And we'll start with Omega, because I know, Dave, you have three.
Yeah.
Being the freaking Monopoly man with all the expensive cards. Do we see a reprint? And also, part two, do we see a need for this card to get hit? Dave, we'll start with you.
I, as of now, the card has no reason to get hit. As far as a reprint, I think the earliest possible choice would be a Gold Series in next March, April.
Yeah.
And if it doesn't happen in that, I could see it being over a year before we see a reprint.
Like, and maybe higher rarity or lower rarity or?
I believe it would probably come out as like a super, maybe as like a, you know, a super, like, you know, the gold series rarities, like the gold rare and all that.
Yeah, like a gold secret.
Or, which I actually would be a fan of, and I don't think this would affect the price at all, really, an OTS ulti.
That would make it more expensive on the ulti
it
side.
It would look really good as an OTS ulti. Really good. But yeah, that's it.
I feel like they could pull like a Trish with it too. They could just reprint it as a secret rare again.
Oh yeah, you're definitely right. They could do that. A lot of Wing Raiders, they did the reprint secret.
Yeah.
And I think they soon followed it up with the ulti reprint. Or was the ulti print already out?
Actually, I don't know.
No, the secret came out before.
Yeah, that's what I think.
Yeah, no, that's how it was. Yeah. Because the original was like 40 or 50, and then the secret reprint.
I think the reprint, so yeah, it was around 20. But Adam, to sort of finish out the question, do you see a need for Omega to get hit?
Not really. Like, I mean, unless Dark Synchro or like whatever was abusing it in the OCG, like, gets really popular here for whatever reason.
Yeah. Like, I mean, they hit level leader, so that kind of controls that.
Yeah, that's true.
Because the card right now sits at around 50 to 60 and up. And I'm just trying to think, like...
Another reason they could have hit it is because of the new Foolish Burial of Belongings card. Like, you could just send that, Dark Pose or whatever, and then just do, like, that lock you could with, like, the Omega.
Yeah.
Attack you.
Uh-huh.
So, I mean, that might have been another reason they hit it. I'm not absolutely sure, though. Like, I just feel like that's kind of stupid.
Yeah, because usually when we see a card this expensive for that long, and it's only gradually gone up over time is because it's being played in a lot of decks. I know a lot of decks that can play a level 8 tune or a level 8 synchro, they either go with this or a Crystal Wing, but obviously Omega's a little easier to make because you don't need a synchro non-tuner. But when we look at decks that really play this card, besides Psyframe, which let's not talk about Psyframe, but besides Psyframe, we really just have your degenerate hand loop decks like Dark Synchro and Synchro Fusionist. And this is to both of you. Do you think this warrants that price, or is it just because of how hard it is to get this card, being only one print secret rare out of Wing Raiders? Adam, we'll start with you.
I feel like, I don't know. I just feel like it's kind of hard to get, and that just people just aren't buying the set like that much at all. So.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like that's why it's so expensive, and that just
it and just in really general, just being a really, it's just good, a really good.
Yeah, it's a really good generic synchro too. So, yeah. I mean, that could be another reason like why it's so expensive. But yeah, I think it definitely shouldn't be like $60. I feel like that's a little pricey.
Yeah,
I feel like 40 would be like a better like range for this, like sort of like a Crystal Wing maybe. But
yeah, Crystal Wings are on the rise. I mean, we can include them here, but they're like 50, going upwards of $50 right now.
See that? That's crazy.
Yeah, they're really on the rise. And Dave, what do you think about Omegas right now?
I think it's also just purely lack of quantity in the market. I mean, the set wasn't that good.
Yeah, just minus, besides Omega, you know, and Trish.
Minus some of the, I think some of the Speedroid stuff came out.
Oh yeah, Terratop came out. Terratop and
Ticket. Well, I mean, even look at Terratop. What is Terratop, like $6-$7?
Yeah, I think it's almost like $10 or something.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's not, I don't think Omega's that great of a card, actually, because unless your opponent has one card in their hand or two cards and they have, like, limited resources, you'll activate the effect, take one card out of their six-card hand, you know, assuming, like, they draw for turn and all that, and then you have to hope you hit something that completely wrecks their turn, and if you didn't, you just removed that 2800, you know, wall that was in their way, and now you're even more open to receive attacks. So I don't think it's super broken. Every once in a while it might be busted, but I think it's just purely that there's not a lot of them in the market right now, and people that have them are just hanging on to them because they don't want to have to pick them up again for $60.
Mm-hmm. True.
Interesting. And I'm on eBay right now.
Yep.
And I don't see... Here, let me just double check. Let me spell this right this time. There we go. Because, like, there are none that are coming up. Yeah, $60. And there are, like, no other Cyframe Lord Omegas on eBay.
Yeah, I mean...
Yes,
yeah.
I don't see any. This could be skewed, but there's one going for $55 right now that I actively see.
Yeah, even if there is a good amount of them on eBay, like, at $50-$60, like, ABC doesn't need it, Blue Eyes doesn't need it, Metal Foe doesn't need it, Burning Abyss doesn't need it, you know what I mean? None of the meta decks need it, so...
And you can play in Metal Foes to recycle your counter, but that's about it.
Yeah, it doesn't have a huge utility. Like, it's not a necessary, like, Bujinte Tsukiyomi is in ABC.
Yeah, exactly.
And that card went up, you know, from a $3 ulti to now, like, $20-$25.
That's pretty good.
Yeah. Let's see here. Let me just check TCG Player.
Yeah, TCG Player has a lot more of them, but they're a lot higher prices as well.
Yeah. But if a deck were to come out all of a sudden, or all of a sudden a deck could abuse the hell out of Cyframe Lord Omega, I could see it being $100.
Oh, yeah.
Like, for example...
Cyframe Lord Omega right now is $59, and it's on a steady price trend.
I mean, $60 is a lot for that kind of a card, you know, so, especially because it's not, you know, you know, completely busted.
Amazing, yeah. I mean, it's really good, but it's nowhere near, like, broken.
It's a niche card.
Yeah, like, it has, definitely has a specific niche that it works well in.
All right, let's take a look at Solemn Strike.
Strike.
Yeah, that's a Solemn good card. Strike. Gosh, unlimited near mint. I see one going for 40 first at near mint, 38.40, and then you got your mega packs, which are sitting around 35. So if you're going to want to invest in tins, pulling a strike might make you a little bit of money on that. And it's just Solemn Strike, which is just a good card to have in general. Solemn Strike sitting around pretty high, and I think they went up.
Yeah, that's an example of a card that when it gets reprinted, it doesn't affect the price at all.
Uh-huh.
I mean, what's the difference between originals and reprints? Like $5-$10?
Yeah, steady $5-$10. Although there are some Bosch one. I see one Bosch one, the unlimited, listed for $35, which matches a first ed near mint mega pack one. But the first ed Solemn Strikes from Bosch are sitting around 40. There's one unlimited for 40, but not too much of a difference.
Yeah. I think the same thing could happen with Omega. I mean, if it did get reprinted, even like a gold secret, which I think it would be, just because I think it would warrant gold secret over gold. I feel like it might drop Omegas to like 40s, but the reprints would still be like 20-25. So, I mean, a lot of these cards we're talking about, even if they get a reprint, it doesn't necessarily just destroy the price.
Yeah.
Usually that only happens when they like reprint it as like an overly accessible card. Kind of, I mean, this is a extreme example, but like Dweller used to be $20 and then it got reprinted and it dropped to $1. But that it's not because it got reprinted. It's because it got reprinted in mass quantity. I think I had like 30 Abyss Dwellers at one point. If they had reprinted it as like a hard to pull super, it might have dropped Dweller to $15 or $10, but because of the quantity, and, you know, just tanked it. Even originals are now like $2, if that.
Yeah, and I'm looking at Crystal Wing right now as well. $38.99 unlimited near mint. First sets are probably around $45.
Yeah.
That's pretty expensive and unforeseen. I didn't really expect this card to go up any more than it did. I always thought it was around 30. Now it's pushing 40 in some cases. 50.
I remember picking those up when they were 20s, and then they just kept going up just because of Metal Foe becoming a good deck. pooping out Zulkins.
Zulkin is also, yeah. One of those cards that enables this card and make it more actively played.
Yeah.
And one last thing I guess we'll look at. Moon Glacier was up to 2025. Now, Unlimiteds are back down to 12. And highest, I don't see any more going for 20 right now on eBay. Or not eBay, TCG Player. Do you guys think this is because the Treat Toad hype has died down? And do you think it's going to resurge once Treat Toad is out? Because I feel like other decks, I guess I should ask, do you guys think other decks besides Mermail are going to try and play this? Maybe possibly just like Toads, actual like frogs?
Moon Glacier?
Moon Glacier, yeah.
I don't think so.
Yeah, no, I don't think so either. But it's definitely one of those cards that's getting up there.
Yeah, I was just looking at the price for Jumbo Drill, and it's very low, so I don't know if I don't think it would rise for any reason because it's been printed like a billion times. Uh-huh. It's super rare, but
yeah, it's pretty low.
But Magna Reverse, though, I was also looking at earlier, and that card's like, I think, like, anywhere it's upwards of like 15 to 20. Just because of the.
Sell mine.
You should.
Ujinji, Tsukiyomi Altis are up to $25. So I think mine up for 20. They're almost going up to 30, dude. I see somebody has a first ed near mint Alti listed for $47.99.
Wow, it is ABC's most broke opening.
That's good to see.
I just looked up Magnaverse, and I saw they were at 20s to 15s, like, I think a day ago, and now they're already dropped back down to, like, there seems like they're selling at 10. They're selling around 10-ish. But that's still quite a bit for a super rare the pack. I mean, it's a pack no one really bought, I don't feel like, because that was kind of an ass pack.
Yeah.
So I can see why it is a little bit of expensive, and just because ABC is abusing it.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, I think that'll pretty much do it for that section, so we can move on here and get to our last section, which is just OCG stuff, and we don't really have to cover too much in this if there's not really too much to cover. Anything outstanding in the OCG that we see at the moment other than, like, you know, what's topping?
Zodiac Beasts. They're
those
broken.
Look pretty hype.
Yeah, I think we can save that for another topic, but we can just sort of wrap up with just Zodiac Beasts in general. Adam, your thoughts?
On the Zodiac Beast archetype?
Yeah.
I feel like in the OCG, it's taken it, like, it definitely, like, made its place. I don't think it's, like, super, I'd say it's kind of like an ABC right now. Like, it's just, like for the TCG, like, it's just getting its start.
Uh-huh.
So people are trying to, like, figure out, like, what exactly they're going to do with the deck and, like, how to make it contend with, like, the main meta there, which I still believe is ABC and, like, Metal Phone, like, all that kind of...
Yeah.
Yeah.
But,
Dave?
Yeah, definitely feel like it's going to be super strong in the future.
Dave, on to you.
I'm looking at the org right now and the last update for all the deck lists that were posted for Japan.
Yeah, you want to give us a layout?
And, I mean, Junichi shows up probably 65%, and then you got probably about 25-30% ABC, and then the rest is surprisingly just Dark Lord and Frogzoic. Then you got, like, Masked Hero sprinkled in there. There's, like, a DDD here and there, Blue Eyes. So it's definitely making an impact slightly more than ABC.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how it would do over here just because we have different cards and our meta is a little different.
Yeah.
But I think it will, when it comes out, either push ABC aside or stand right beside it.
Yeah, definitely. That's good that you ended up bringing up all those decks there that are pretty much...
Also Dark Lord.
Yeah, standard Dark Lord and standard just decks that are topping in general over there. It's nice to see. So thank you for bringing that up. And I think that'll conclude our first podcast-esque video here, first podcast-type discussion. Still don't have a name for it yet. Perhaps you'll see it in the title of this video anyways. And if you guys enjoyed, and if you want to see more of this stuff in the future, and if you have any suggestions to help improve, we'll take any criticism. Hope you guys enjoyed. Like I said, if you want to see more of this stuff, leave a like, leave your comments. Like I said, any suggestions, and this is definitely really fun to do. I got to thank Dave and Adam here for joining me with this. For the help in that discussion, because
no problem.
Do this by myself. So yeah, that's gonna wrap it up here, guys. Hope you enjoyed. As always, winner kill to sign out. We'll see you in the next one.
Peace.